हाय राजात।
हाय, हेलो।
हाय राजात,
हाय हाय
थैंक यू फॉर
मानसी।
कमिंग टू कम ऑन इंस्टाग्राम विद फॉर अ लाइव सेशन विद अस, एंड अ स्पेशल थैंक्स टू नियोगी बुक्स फॉर फैसिलिटेटिंग द सेम। राजात, आई जस्ट फिनिश्ड रीडिंग द बटरफ्लाई इफेक्ट दिस आफ्टरनून, एंड देयर आर सेवरल क्वेश्चंस दैट आर फ्लटरिंग इन माय माइंड अबाउट द प्रमाइस ऑफ द नॉवल। And you know, at some points the novel reminded me of the Orwellian 1984, you know, with its modified food and the neglected many. So what was your inspiration behind writing The Butterfly Effect?
Okay, first let me thank Kitab Khana for arranging this wonderful series of events, and also for inviting me for this one. Let me show the book first. It's The Butterfly Effect, and
Yes.
it's published by Nyogi. There are several inspirations actually. One of the major inspirations is my activism. I had been a climate change activist for now at least 15 to 20 years. When climate change was just a new word, most of the people didn't know what climate change was about. We were lobbying with industry and with governments also to shift from polluting substances to more climate friendly options. So my activism was one of the major inspirations, but beyond that, of course, my reading and other writing, and Orwell, of course, Orwell, Aldous Huxley's work. If you find, you'll find that there is a lot of genetics there. So maybe because this book also has a lot of genetics, Butterfly Effect, Brave New World, and Brave New World Revisited. So Huxley was an early inspiration. And my environment work, health and environment work, where we were working on GMOs also, genetically modified organisms, foodstuff, animals and plants. All of that has played into my writing. And nowadays, there are more and more these kinds of books coming out. So I read most of those. Margaret Atwood is one of them, of course. Then many others. Cormac McCarthy hasn't written about genetics, but he has written real dystopian stuff. So all of these people, plus my activist work, which has a health and environment, a strong health and environment component, including genetics, GMOs, all of that fed into this writing.
Lovely. So, how do you feel about climate change or environmental crisis, which plays part in, all the different places in your novel? So do you think the pandemic, this was a question that Sudeshna asked one of our readers, asking that do you think the pandemic and climate change have any correlation in some ways, the current pandemic and climate change?
Yeah, see, what is happening is most of the things that are happening around us, that is happening to the environment, disease and climate change, pollution, all of these have the fingerprints of human beings on it. And climate change and pandemic, this particular pandemic, they are kind of, cognate. They have started for the same reason. Human beings have been involved. So there are several theories that link climate change to this pandemic. One of those is, there's this Professor Bendel, Jem Bendel, who teaches in Cambria, University of Cambria. He's saying that the bats, where coronavirus is, bats are the natural host of coronavirus. And these bats have been displaced because of climate change, because of the warming planet, from their natural habitats. And now they are living closer to humans, which is why, which has given the opportunity for this virus from jumping from bats to humans. That's one of the theories. And there are several others which can, which links climate change to disease. Not only disease, like you now find very poisonous snakes on the beaches of California, and the habitats of the snakes are very, very far away, but they are now moving northwards because of the warming seas. All of these things are happening because of climate change. And so yes, the pandemic can be connected to climate change in several ways, and to human action also. Like, we are cutting down trees, we are building roads through forested areas, we are logging for wood. We have made this chicken into a kind of a factory, the broiler chicken. It's like a factory to produce meat for human beings. All of these animals carry viruses. Forests are full of animals which carry viruses, dangerous viruses. But these viruses were circulating very coldly in the wild. They were not coming close to humans. But now that humans are cutting down forests, expanding urbanization, and all these things are happening together, humans are coming closer to viruses, and viruses are getting an opportunity to jump into humans, into our system, infecting humans. So yes, climate change can be implicated for several things, including this pandemic. If we leave out the other theories about, you know, laboratory development, bioweapons and all, some of which are in the book. Yeah.
It's more fictionalized than, it's conspiracy theory rather than, you know, what could actually work. There are a lot of theories going around, so. But yeah, so, you know, the book is set in, largely set in three countries.
Mm.
It's India, UK and Korea. So what necessitated this white canvas, you know, why were we jumping so many countries across the book?
I think the simple answer is, you know, environmental problems, health and environmental problems are borderless. They cross continents very easily, they cross country borders very easily. And because the book is about that, it's mostly a health and environment issue that is the theme of the book. So naturally, the story has to move from one part of the world to others. And then, as you have seen, you have read the book, the characters are also from several places. If you are writing about climate change, you cannot really avoid that. If you read Amitabh Ghosh's latest novel, A Gun Island, it is also spread over several places. It's in Sundarbans, then it goes to Italy, and then it goes to the US. And climate change itself, climate change, pandemics, these are, you know, these are kind of global phenomena. They have all kinds of ramifications across the world, across peoples and across countries. Climate change is even more complex because from wildfires to migration, everything is happening because of climate change. And initially they seem unrelated. But when you're writing a novel, you can do that. You can expand the setting and bring it all in.
You can make the connections.
Yeah, you can make the connections, yeah.
So, you know, when the novel began, the Butterfly Effect began, it is set in a dystopian future, a dystopian future of Calcutta, largely. The canvas, you know, seemed uncannily real to me, like being from Calcutta, being born and brought up there, and like the current times with the dread and the disease which eats into the city at its core, and yet there is a section of society which continues to live on as if nothing has really happened. So do you foresee such an end to civilization? Or do you think this pandemic will actually help us to get our act together and, like, you know, behave differently?
Yeah, this is a good question actually. We are not futurists, we cannot say what will happen, but we can look for certain signals. What I hope and what might be already happening is the climate change movements, which have been energized because of people like Greta Thunberg and others. These climate change movements will be joining hands with all these good people who are working for us to help humanity in this hour of crisis. These two things might join hands. All the goodness that is also flowing during this pandemic that is around us, those energies will join hands with the climate movements, and hopefully we will have a slightly better world. That's possible. But side by side with this, there are, you know, these armed gunboat scenarios. You read in the papers about these billionaires from the US, they are kind of escaping to New Zealand, where they have already built their bunkers in case there's a doomsday scenario, there's a nuclear war or a pandemic. So it's already happening. There are these group of people who are kind of escaping into their safe havens, already built underground or in other countries like New Zealand. New Zealand has a lot of these, you know, underground bunkers where these rich people are hiding. So utopia and dystopia will coexist, but when you are writing a book, nowadays I've begun to feel that you should also talk about positive futures, not only darkness, because it gives people hope. Otherwise, it's all despair. So for this book, Butterfly Effect, if you read till the end, you will find that there's an indication that the story will go on because the antidote hasn't been found. And actually, I'm making this into a trilogy. So I'm hoping that the next book, which I've just about begun to write, will have a more positive future, a better future, people working together for a better future. So yeah, let's see.
So when can we expect the second book to come out now?
I don't know. It takes a lot of time. I don't know. 2-3 years, who knows. I'm doing other work parallelly with that, yeah, translation and stuff. So let's see.
We've just also read your translation of Calcutta Nights.
Yeah.
That's really, really beautiful.
Very interesting.
When we see that parts of your novel has got these amazing moving descriptions of the mountains of Korea, it almost transports you to that magical valley, and you know, you evoke such a beautiful landscape as if, you know, you've been familiar of that like a native. So can you tell us a bit what went into the research of writing such beautiful landscapes, and what inspired you? Like, have you lived in Korea, been to those areas, and hence?
Yeah, I've been to those areas, of course. Otherwise, it's difficult to write. You can write from imagination totally. Kafka has this book called America, which is not one of his very common or popular books. Kafka never went to America, but he had written a book called America. And it's a beautiful, it's his last novel, unfinished. So yeah, that aside, I did visit Korea and stayed there for about a month, more than a month, on a fellowship. And I have visited these places, but I did a lot of research also. I made a lot of friends, and while I was writing the novel, I was asking them again and again. Every point I clarify from them. And my habit is to go into detailing when I'm writing a novel. That's sometimes a bad habit, people have told me, because if you go into too much detailing, you know, the story can get stalled sometimes. Too much detail can stop the reader. Yeah, you can get a bit slowed down. But yeah, that's how I write. I did a lot of research, I met people, I visited these places, these mountains. North Korea, no, but yeah, South Korea, of course, yeah. And I checked with people who lived there again and again after coming back. I took photographs, I took videos, all of those things. I read their literature also.
Coming back to the GMO topic that we started our conversation with, in the novel, you know, there's a debate between Tanmay and David, and you explain both sides of genetic engineering through their debate, you know, their conversations throughout that period in the novel. So which side do you lean to more? We are obviously guessing to David's side, but what is your personal take on GM crops, and how is it actually affecting the environment?
It's affecting health, actually, and it can affect the environment also. Yeah. Of course, I am against GMO, use of GMOs or let us say I am against modifying plants, genetically modifying plants, not always animals, because GM technology can be useful in medicine, you know. There are very good GM medicines that are being discovered.